Good evening. It's good to be with you tonight. For those of you who don't know who I am, my name is Andy Steiger, and I am the director of Apologetics Canada. If you don't know what apologetics is, it's a Greek word, apologia. It means to give an answer or a reason. And in the Bible, in particular, the Apostle Peter uses this word in 1 Peter 3:15, saying that we should to give an answer or a reason for the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. And so the whole idea of the conference, the Apologetics Canada Conference, is really to talk about our hope and to ask a simple but profound question. Do you have hope? And if you do have hope, where is it found? And do you have good reason for the hope that you have? And so as a conference, that's our desire. Is it part of the lecture series that we have leading up to the conference like tonight? It has a lot to do with that as well, about our hope and where our hope is found. We're privileged tonight to have Dr. Mary Poplin with us. And in fact, we've got right now a whole host of speakers that have either arrived or are arriving. In fact, we had Nancy Piercy has already arrived yesterday. And Nancy Piercy and Mary Poplin, we've been throughout the day going strong. We were here at CBC for a chapel this morning. And then we did we had a lunch for over 110 pastors and professors at Northview today. And then we just had a leadership dinner, and now we're here tonight, and this is so good to be with you. And then tomorrow, it all starts over again. And we have the Apologetics Canada Conference kicking off. The doors open at 5:30, and the conference starts at 7 p.m. If you've never heard of the Apologetics Canada Conference before, I just wanted to quickly let you know about it. This conference is something that we've been doing each year at the beginning of March. This is our fifth conference. And this year we have a number of incredible speakers, including Mary Poplin. We also have Nancy Piercy, who I've mentioned. We have Sean McDowell. We have people like Luis Marcos from Houston Baptist University. He is a C.S. Lewis expert. He'll be talking on C.S. Lewis, and if you've ever read books like Chronicles of Narnia, he's going to be talking about how C.S. Lewis made an argument for God from myth and desire. Then we also have over 17 breakout sessions, and we have on a variety of different subjects. And this year, we're doing something a little bit different that we've never done before. We're having a series of TED Talk-style addresses that are going to be in the area of rethinking education. And in fact, that's why we have Dr. Poplin with us, is she has done incredible work in the area of education. And so we wanted her to come and to speak on that. And then she's doing a breakout session at the conference on that subject. In fact, she's written a number of books. One of them is called Finding Calcutta. The subtitle is What Mother Teresa Taught Me About Meaningful Work and Service. This is an incredible book just talking about her story and about how she found hope in Jesus Christ and how it's impacted her understanding of the world. And in fact, even the way that she does her research as a professor. And that ultimately led her to writing her newest book, which is Reality Secular? And the subtitle is Testing the Assumptions of Four Global Worldviews. And really, this is part of what she's going to be speaking on this evening with us. And I am absolutely delighted to get to be here and to hear more from her. She's an incredible individual. She has her PhD from the University of Texas, and she works at the university at Claremont Graduate University. She is a teacher of PhD students, and she also supervises their dissertations. And has been doing incredible work in the area of education, specifically in the works in the span of K-12 higher education. Professor Poplin began her career as a public school teacher and conducts research largely inside of schools and classrooms, and more recently on highly effective teachers in urban poor schools. She and eight colleagues conducted extensive research from 2005 to 2009 with 30 highly effective teachers in 9 low-performing urban K-12 schools in Los Angeles County. And her prior work included a study of voices inside the classroom. It's fascinating what she's learned through this research and just her ability to communicate it. Not only have I learned, though, that she's a great teacher, she's also a great learner.
My 7-year-old taught her how to play Uno last night, and she beat him twice. Would you please welcome to the stage Dr. Mary Poplin.
I tried not to beat him. Almost every card I had was one of those plus cards, for those of you who know Uno, so it wasn't... anyone could have beat with the hand I had. Well, I'm really happy to be here tonight, and happy to share with you some of the things I've learned in my struggle to actually follow Christ. So I think I need to start with a preface that I was 41 before I came to Christ, and I was already a tenured professor, and I was teaching all the things that you hope no one ever teaches your child. And I was doing all the things that you hope one of your children never does. But I had become so, my mind had become so dark that I am like the perfectly described by Paul in Romans 1. I just want to read that passage to you. I gave my testimony earlier in the chapel, and you probably can get access to that. And I'm not going to go through it tonight, but my struggle has been to right my mind after 41 years of going the wrong direction. So Paul says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who suppress the truth in their unrighteousness." That's exactly what I was doing as a teacher, suppressing the truth because of my unrighteousness. "Because that which is known about God is evident within them, for God made it evident to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, his eternal power, and his divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood through what has been made, so they are without excuse. For even though they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks, but they became futile in their speculations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing to be wise, they became as fools." And that was that was a perfect description of my state at 41 when Jesus met me with a dream and showed me the real condition of my soul. And I was both horrified and hopeful. So if you can be both at the same time. So I want to talk a little bit about, I know that this the title of this has changed about 4 times, because at first I proposed this title, and then I heard that you wanted more about a broader spectrum of worldviews, and then I heard you wanted teacher research. So I'm going to try to do 3 talks in one. I'm not sure I'll be very successful at it, but I'm going to try to weave them together. So one of the first places I went, I actually had been raised in the church, in a Methodist church, but it just hadn't taken, I think. In a way, I probably would have told you that when I got to college, I was a Christian, but I wasn't. I shared with the students today that you can be born a Muslim or a Jew, or you can be born a Hindu or born a Buddhist, but you cannot be born a Christian. And I suggested that those who hadn't made that decision do it before lunch. And I think probably after my testimony, they were frightened enough to know. I don't want to be like her. So being in the secular university and then becoming a Christian has been a real challenge. Mother Teresa told me, basically, one of the last things she said to me, she didn't really know me. She just, she knew I was from the United States. And one of my jobs was working with sick babies. And I was also a runner back to the mother house. So occasionally I'd be waiting there at the mother house and she'd walk out of the office. And one day she walked out and said to me, "You know, God does not call everybody to work with the poor, like he called us to work with. And God does not call everybody to live poor, like he called us to live. But God calls everybody to a Calcutta. You have to find yours." And I felt like I had really just been hit. Like, I almost felt like I'd physically been hit. So here I am at that time, 44, and this woman is telling me I don't know what what I'm supposed to be doing. And she was right. But why did she call it her Calcutta? She called it her Calcutta because whatever our destiny is, whether it's inside the church or outside the church, our destiny is always going to involve both a kind of elation of doing what we want to do and also a struggle. It's like Jesus said, they hated me, so they're going to hate you. So being in the secular university is an interesting calling. So I had to figure out what it was I believed, because when I came back from Mother Teresa's, I couldn't explain her to any of my colleagues in a language that they could understand. If I did use the Christian language, they just thought it was silly and just sort of disregarded that part. So I found myself sort of explaining her as though she were a secular humanist. And then I had this huge crisis when I realized I was a liar. I was really lying about her. And then I had to ask myself, why is it that I work at what's supposedly called the free open marketplace of ideas, and I can't actually explain Mother Teresa? I just want to say to those of you who are standing back there, there are seats in the front, and I have never bitten anyone. So worldviews are pretty much like the operating systems of a computer. I mean, that's sort of a mechanical explanation of it. But they determine what we'll see, how we'll interpret what we see, and ultimately what we'll actually do about it. So one of the examples, and I only break worldviews into four categories. One of the examples is the abortion debate. So if you're a material naturalist, the fetus up to a certain point, which they always debate what that point is simply a mass of cells that can be used for scientific experimentation. It can be used for all kinds of things, including just better face cream. But from the secular humanist perspective, it doesn't really matter when it becomes a child or whether it's a child. There are some people who care about that, like Peter Singer. So he decides that when it can feel pain, and then now he's discovered it feels pain pretty early. So we're backing off of that one. But the secular humanists basically are into individual freedom. So the idea is, no matter what it is, it's the person who's carrying its right to determine its fate. To a pantheist, this is a human being that's being reincarnated, and if it's aborted, then it has to go through a whole nother life cycle. In monotheism, of course, in Judeo-Christianity, it is child. You know, there's never a word. I'm going to write a book someday about the words that aren't in the Bible. Pregnant is not in the Bible. Being with child is in the Bible. So we know that it's a child made in the image of God, and it has a purpose for its life, and God loves that child. So that's just a quick example of how the four worldviews sort of color the way that we look at the world. I'm going to start with material naturalism because we talked about the sort of controversy in the title of Controversy of Origins, and that's where the controversy of origins is lodged. So the faith of material naturalists is that there's nothing in the world, nothing in the universe other than matter, energy, and the laws and processes that govern that matter and energy. They include in this human consciousness is nothing but matter, it's just nothing but biochemical reality, conscience, your love, intuition, religious beliefs. So they're really not looking. A materialist is not really looking for whether there is a God. They're looking for the biochemistry that makes us believe in God. So David Sloan Wilson says, trying to discover why we believe is more intriguing than the debate over whether anyone up there is looking down. One of the major points of the material naturalist is they believe that Christians believe in God because of the things we don't know. So that's the God of the gaps argument you hear a lot about. They believe that that's why we believe in God, is because there's certain things that we don't know, and so we attribute those things we don't know to him. John Lennox, who's probably one of my favorite apologists, he is an Oxford mathematician. His brain is on steroids, but he looks like Santa Claus. It's a great combination. He also laughs like Santa Claus, so maybe Apologetics Canada can get him someday. John Lennox says, the God of the Gaps argument is like saying that just because we know everything about the internal combustion engine, it means Henry Ford did not exist. Right? It's a sort of same argument. John Lennox has a way of just cutting through the arguments of the atheists, and you can find a lot of his debates with atheists. So the problem is that, I always point at the screen. Science, we call this scientism. This is what several Christians have labeled the idea that science is everything and they can explain everything. And the problem with this is the accepted methodology of science only begins after the identification of material. So naturally, science cannot say anything outside of that realm. You've got to have material in front of you, and so it can only state facts about those interactions and those observations. Now, I don't doubt that biochemistry has a lot to do with the way we think and the way we are, but what a material naturalist would try to say is that my brain changed and therefore I started believing in this God that doesn't exist. The reality is, once I came to Christ, I do believe if you had given me any kind of neurological exam before that, and several years after that, you would have found a different brain. But it would not have been the biochemistry that caused that to happen. It would have been my relationship with Jesus Christ. So let's look at scientism, people in who are scientism believers, or material naturalists. Their major strategy in the debate with evolution is to say there's only number one in five. There's number one is naturalistic evolution. This is atheist evolution. It's what Dawkins talks a lot about. And number five would be the six-day creationists. And I'm not going to recommend any of these to you, but I'm going to inform you. And I'd like to say that for those of you who work in the church with young adults, or those of you who are pastors, if the church actually taught all five of these, they would be the only place in the universe teaching all five of them. Okay, because a lot of times people get into whatever one they believe, and that's kind of the only one they teach. But I'm going to kind of try to share the differences. Now, the reason that the strategy for the atheists and secularists is to use only number one and five is that they believe they can make five look foolish. Okay? Number one through four all actually believe that the universe is about 14 billion years old and that the Earth is about 4.5 billion years old. So all and everyone that's in white is shared by some Christians. Okay? So the only naturalistic evolution is atheist and secularist, but all the others are shared by Christians. Now, the other thing I'll say right off the bat is all five of them believe in something called microevolution. That means that the finches on Galapagos, when there's drought, their beaks begin, the baby finches, begin to have beaks that are thicker and more hard. And that's so they can break open shell seeds that are going to be more difficult to break during a drought. Now, every single one of those people believes in that, and they believe that white moss can turn dark in England during the Industrial Revolution, and they believe that bacteria morph to resist drugs, to become drug resistant, okay? However, everybody from 3, 4, and 5 points out that those are still finches. They've not turned into seagulls, right? They're actually finches, and when it rains on the island, their beaks are going to go back to their original less hard and less thick source or substance. So let me describe the ones that are Christian. Theistic evolution essentially believes pretty much most of what naturalistic evolution believes, but they also believe that God designed it this way, that this is the way, this was the plan of God. He knew what was going to happen. He knew that ultimately human beings would emerge from this. And this is led by people like Francis Collins, who is actually the head of the National Institute of Health in the United States, and he's written a book on science and faith, a couple of books now on science and faith, and he heads an organization called BioLogos. And when I was doing this chapter, I was subscribed to all these people's websites, so I got all their updates. And it's very interesting. I mean, that alone is a very interesting thing to do for those of you who are teachers or doing homeschooling or just interested in these subjects. So BioLogos is the forum that does this. And I would say that, honestly, most Christians who are scientists in secular universities are probably in this camp in general. I would say more of them are theistic evolution people than not. Now, intelligent design is probably the group. This one comes out of Seattle, out of the Discovery Institute. There are a number of philosophers of science and scientists who work in this area, and they resist evolution. They don't believe that there's enough evidence that a species can ever turn into another species. And also, their foundational belief is this, which is kind of a what you might call a scientific revolution. Those of you who ever read Kuhn's book on scientific revolutions, I'm sure not too many people have, but if you have, you'll remember his term. Intelligent design people are proposing this, that the prime cause of the universe, the prima causa of the universe, is not material. So everybody, when they search for the cause of origins, they're talking about material. You know, what lit the first Big Bang, or what was the first element that existed? What were the first chemicals that existed? What the intelligent design advocates say is the prime cause of the universe is the step before that, and that is an intelligence. And they say that because it always takes an intelligence to create something anyway, but especially to create something that's so finely tuned. And so you know about the Earth being so finely tuned. If we were just a little closer to the sun, we'd burn up. If we were a little further away, we'd freeze to death. I mean, and you look at all this sort of emphasis now. What are they looking for when they look for planets inside galaxies far from us? They're looking for the substance that creates life, right? So the intelligent design people are saying you can't get something this orderly out of just an explosion or out of a process like evolution. The older special creationist group is actually led by Gerald Schroeder on the Jewish side and Hugh Ross on the Protestant side. And Hugh Ross is actually a Canadian. He was the youngest head of your department, I don't know, something like Department of Astronomy, that's not what it's called, but in Canada ever. I think he was 17 when he took that position. He's like one of these really brainy people. He's actually now down in Los Angeles, and he runs an institute called Reasons to Believe, which is actually quite good. What they do is they take the latest scientific findings, and then they go back to the Bible to see, does this finding contradict anything in the Bible? And they find that it doesn't. And that's a very interesting website also. All of these are. And then the Young Earth Special Creationist, God said it was 6 days, and he can do it any way he wanted to do it. And that is that institute is also interesting because they also present the latest data and then argue from a young earth creation point of view. And that institute's called the Institute for Creation Research. You may have similar but different institutes here in Canada. Now, I want to just sort of quickly go through what are the arguments against both forms of evolution, theistic evolution and naturalistic evolution. And they're these. One, even Darwin said you should find a lot of transitional beings. There should be a lot of sort of half ape, half humans. There should be a lot of every kind of life form in its middle form. And there aren't. Even Stephen Jay Gould, an atheist at Harvard, proposed this sort of elaborate design called punctuated equilibrium because he recognized, and they all recognize, that the transitional forms that they thought they would find have not been found. Second, the Cambrian explosion, a period of time when what you see is that we went very rapidly from single-cell organisms to much more complicated organisms at what they call higher taxon-level disparity. And that that happened too quickly. So there wasn't a time for an evolution from a lesser level being to a higher level. So the body plans. So major changes in body plans preceded minor ones. Third, and perhaps the most deadly of the criticisms against evolution, is the idea of mutations. Mutations are about 90%, 95 to 99% of the time, they're either neutral to the organism or they're detrimental to the organism. Mutations rarely increase data. They actually decrease data in the DNA. So that's one of the biggest criticisms. And common design, people say, well, this is common descent. So we can see that these animals look increasingly complex, and people argue that's not necessarily common descent. It could be common design. That is, God just simply uses the same materials to make many different beings, just like we use metal, for example. We don't use metal. We can use metal for children's toys or bombs. So those are the major arguments against both evolutionary theories, and these are the common arguments for it. One is the genetic similarities between humans and apes and other species, that the DNA is actually very similar. The second one, which has been somewhat discredited recently, is that there's all this junk, what they used to call junk DNA. You've got DNA that they don't find any sort of, an RNA that they don't find any sort of function for, but however, now they are finding it. And common descent, that there is this tree of life and it went a particular direction. Now, here's the major point I want to make. When I go around to universities, I meet a lot of Christian students in the colleges who are in science. And in fact, 2 or 3 weeks ago, there was a study published by the Barna Foundation in the Barna Group in the United States. And it said that they did this big survey of young adults in church congregations. So they found that between 18 and 28 who are in the church, 50% of them want to go into science. Okay? I personally think that one of the reasons is that science is kind of the last holdout on being able to say there is such a thing as truth. And I think Christians are drawn to science because they know that they can, that still exists in that field, and that's what they want to do for all kinds of reasons. Now, the thing that I want to share and try to convince people of is that you could have 5 people working on a particular string of DNA. Okay, so you've got these like RNA strings, and people say, well, we think this particular segment or part of RNA or is actually contributing to a particular kind of cancer. You could have 5 different scientists working on a team, working on a grant, and every single one of those scientists could believe something different about origins. You could have an atheist, naturalistic evolution person. You could have an intelligent design, an old earth creationist, a young earth creationist, and a theistic evolution person. And they would be using exactly the same scientific method, and they would be coming up with exactly the same findings because they're working on pre-existing material, and they have a methodology for that that was discovered by a Christian, Francis Bacon, who believed that the scientific method would allow us to, whatever we found through the scientific method, would allow us to actually understand more about the mind of God. Because the more you understood about the universe, the more you would understand the mind of God. And he, even in his introduction, so if students in, let's say students in science classes read Francis Bacon's first piece introducing this methodology, if they read that in the very preface, he talks about the danger of using science for evil purposes. He talks about that because he's a Christian, right? He was a Christian. So those are the kinds of things that, for example, a classical education would have students reading the beginning of this. They'd have students reading Newton's work. Newton actually wrote more in theology than he wrote in science and math. We don't even really realize that, but these kinds of things exist because science basically comes out of Christianity, but it's science with a moral tether. And that is, of course, the problem of materialism. Materialism's limitations is they cannot allow for a single miracle. Miracles cannot exist because that really bumps up their system. And there's an excellent series, I ordered this book. I thought I was ordering one book, and Amazon was charging me like $70 for this, and I thought, this has got to be a pretty serious book. But when I got it, it was two volumes. So Craig Keener, who is a theologian at Asbury Theology School in Kentucky, has actually written two volumes on miracles. And the references in those two volumes are longer than the text. I mean, it's just amazing. He's gone from early miracles all the way up to miracles that today, and really begins to question, because the question about Kant not believing in miracles, he basically says, even if one miracle were to have existed, that would negate this whole idea that we have that miracles can't happen. Alvin Plantinga, who's a wonderful philosopher of science, who's also a Christian, says, to believe that there can't be a miracle is to believe that the universe is a closed system, and that has never been established. So no miraculous in materialism. Also, there's no meta-ethic. There's no ethic built into materialism except this. The big animals eat the small animals. The fast animals beat the slow animals. So the only meta-ethic is the strong over the weak. And that's why I think we get confused about materialism being like secular humanism, but I don't think it is, and I'll show you why. But it's because materialists have to borrow the meta-ethic, the ethics of somebody, and they're not going to borrow it from Christianity, so they borrow it from secular humanism. So there's no meta-ethic or moral compass that keeps science on some kind of tether. So that you have all these experiments, I don't know if you read about them now, where you make a child out of three people, and these things are pretty frightening to read. They sound a lot like the old Hitler experiments, and that's because materialism just does not have its own ethic. There's also no answers for big questions. Science has to work from small questions because they're working on material and they have to sort of define their question pretty specific to that material. So questions about the meaning of life are not going to be something that science can deal with. They can't deal with any metaphysical issue. I remember a few years ago, actually it's been probably 20 years ago, Sigmund Koch wrote an article. This was actually before I was a Christian, but I was very drawn to this article. He was the president of the American Psychological Association, and he wrote this article and said that when science, I don't know if you know this, but the social sciences moved themselves out of philosophy, out of being under philosophy, to being under science, and called themselves the social sciences, like psychology. And he said when psychology did that, they adopted the method of the sciences. And when they adopted the method of the sciences, they had to then reduce their questions to something that could be answered by their methodology. So you no longer could ask questions about the meaning of life, about conscience at a big level, or human, or love in a large way. And lastly, this, I guess, frightening thing is you can take science so far, especially this whole idea that you are your biochemistry, to where you have no accountability for one's actions. And you see this when people are defended in court because they have some sort of biochemical problem. And so, of course, then it wasn't really their problem. It was their biochemistry because they actually could not help it. So that's kind of all I want to go through in terms of materialism. You see this primarily in the schools, mostly in the science. There was an excellent, I guess you'd call it excellent, an excellent article in the New York Times at the beginning of, I think it was last fall semester, where a professor at UC Santa Barbara wrote very proudly about his first day of class. And he talks so much about God that when you read the article, you think, if a Christian actually talked that much about God in their entire course, like all the way through, they would probably be under suspicion and maybe even under some kind of attack. But it shows the sort of arrogance of how he gets his students to not believe in God. Now, he teaches the first science course at UC Santa Barbara. So this is what happens to students who are Christian as soon as they get to college. And these people are not only unashamed of it, they're actually very proud of it. So if you want to look something up and read it, you can see that. I also sometimes turn left when I'm supposed to turn right. I want to point out, though, sometimes we think about apologetics like this. Okay, so we're against materialism. We're Christians, and they're materialists. But the truth is there's a huge overlap. Science comes straight out of Christianity. Everything that the materialists believe about, for example, the scientific method or the way the findings, that's also in agreement with Christianity. And so it's also true in terms of what I'm going to share about secular humanism and pantheism. All of these worldviews, even though they're not Christian, overlap with Christianity. There are some things that we share. There are some things that these worldviews believe that we don't believe, like that everything is nothing but material. And then there are things inside Christendom, represented here by the blue triangle, that are over and above that. And I believe, like Leslie Newbegin wrote, that Christians actually have a higher rationality. They have the ability to have a larger or higher rationality. And why is that? It's because we have the mind of Christ. It's because we are seated on high in heavenly places. And it's because Paul tells us that we can discern plausible arguments from truth, right? We can have a transformation of our mind. And for those of us who work in academia or any field, all fields have particular intellectual principles, we have to begin to see our field from another place. We have to see our field from Christ's standpoint and look down upon it and determine what in my field is true, what in my field is false, and what in my field is missing that Christianity adds to it. I am a big proponent of Dallas Willard's work, especially toward the end of his life. He was a professor at USC, a beautiful man. He was a philosopher, had translated Husserl into English and some of his works, and was just an incredible person. I'm a young Christian, right? I'm in my 40s, and I go to my first Christian academic conference, and Dallas Willard was speaking. And I was sitting back, sort of back in the middle of the crowd, and when he started speaking, in my heart, I felt like this is what Jesus would look like as a professor. Or he was just so beautiful. And he was both loving and brilliant. It was incredible. So, in fact, one of his last talks was at our university. And a young woman stood up in the question and answer, and she said, "So you keep talking about truth, so what's truth?" She was saying it sort of in a mocking way. And Dallas Willard stood there and thought for a minute. And then he looked at her and he said, "Truth is reality. And reality is what you run into when you're wrong." Right? It was just, that was the way. But Dallas Willard always said, the thing that we've lost in this culture is the knowledge that there is knowledge inside Christendom that cannot be found anywhere else. You can't find it anywhere else. It's not just about feelings like people say it is. It's about knowledge also. And there are things that you can know as a Christian that you cannot know from any other standpoint. Okay, so the four global worldviews, back to them. We're going to look at secular humanism now. While material naturalism is mostly in the sciences, the natural sciences, secular humanism is filled, has filled the social sciences and the arts and humanities in the secular colleges. So what do these sort of secular humanists claim about secularism? And you can see these arguments everywhere, especially now with the sort of ISIS controversy, right? Religion is evil, right? Secularism is neutral, it's safer, it's necessary for a global world order, it's unbiased, it's more reasonable, it's global, and it's more progressive. You know, about progressive, because that's the big word in the university, you always want to be in the progressive theories and philosophies. C.S. Lewis, who could say everything more easily than anybody else, says this about progressive. He says, if you've taken a wrong turning, then to go forward does not get you any nearer. If you're on the wrong road, progress means doing an about turn and walking back to the right road. And in that case, the man who turns back soonest is the most progressive. I did not turn back the soonest, but I did turn back. I was in my 40s, but. Okay, so those are all plausible arguments. It's plausible. I mean, most people just kind of accept these arguments, that it's neutral, secularism is neutral, it's therefore it's safer, it's not dangerous like religion, it's necessary for a global world order, it's more reasonable and more progressive. So their arguments about religion are this, that faith and that religion is really just about faith and feelings for those who need it. Like, it's just that I'm needy and therefore I needed this and so I came to it. It's optional, it's a personal choice, it's private, it's not public, it is dangerous, and it's not related to really truth or knowledge, real knowledge work, and it's not relevant to our work. So these are all plausible arguments too. So Samuel Huntington, who was a very famous Harvard professor, wrote a book called The Clash of Civilizations. I think it might have been his last book. And he said that the previous world clash of world civilizations between Marxist-Leninist thought and liberal democratic thought was nothing compared to the upcoming clash of civilizations, which will be between Islam and Christianity. Okay, whenever you hear things like this, we really need to instead of sort of taking it in, like most people do, we need to really kind of look at this. Okay, so I'll just take 9/11 and then we'll take the French magazine example. 9/11, if you even read Osama bin Laden's letter about it, you'll find that 9/11 was not against Christianity. They didn't actually hit the National Cathedral. They went for the Pentagon, the World Trade Towers, the White House. Those were their targets, right? And it was because of this mass proliferation and mass dispensation throughout the world of Western secular norms. That's their issue. I'm not defending them, but I'm telling you that their issue was against Western secular norms, the economic system, and particularly this sort of the sort of wholesale pouring out of pornographic movies and basically things that are basically pornography. Now let's take the French magazine, for example. That was a fight between the radical secular left and the radical Islamic right. Again, I'm not saying that Islam loves Christians. I'm just saying that their biggest beef is actually not with a religion, it's more with the actual leftist secular parts of our societies. Now I'm going to hone in specifically on secular humanism. And this is a good picture, although I don't know how well you can see it. This is a man carving himself. when John Paul Sartre died, the Los Angeles Times had a cartoonist named Paul Conrad at the time. And he drew a picture of Sartre actually carving his own statue. And it looked just like him. And Sartre had gotten around between his knees and his ankles. And at the bottom, it gave the dates of his life and his name, and then it said, man makes himself. This is the best picture of secular humanism. Okay, man makes himself. I'm just going to read a piece I don't always like to read when I'm teaching here, but I am going to read this little piece because it tells you everything about secular humanism in a way. If man as the existential, this is from Sartre, conceives himself is undefinable. Man as the existentialist conceives himself is undefinable. It is because at first he's nothing. Only afterward will he be something, and he himself will have made what he will be. Thus, there's no human nature, since there's no God to conceive it. Man is nothing else but what he makes himself. Man is at the start a plan which is aware of itself. Nothing exists prior to this plan. There's nothing in heaven. Man will be what he will have planned to be. When we say man is responsible for himself, we do not only mean that he's that, but that he's responsible for all men. Now that should make you a little nervous, that they're going to be responsible for you too, you and I. So let's look what happened in the social sciences and the humanities to the word truth. It's rarely used anymore. If it's used now, they talk about little t truth, because the idea has changed from the idea that you could find out truth about human nature or social or historical or cultural context, and that the truth really depends on how you perceive it. So we're all just constructing meanings. And the meanings that we construct here in our age will not be the same meanings that we construct later. This is the basis for revising history. So the people in historically said they were doing this, but we know they were really doing this, right? Because we've socially constructed that ourselves. You can socially construct things based on your gender. You can socially construct things based on your class. You can socially construct things based on your culture, or just individually. So the idea that there are any sort of particular basic laws about human nature is sort of thrown out, and we're really just kind of making all this up. And the person who has the power gets to name what's going on. Now, this is very different. It's very different than looking at laws of science. So, for example, no one argues against the law of gravity. No one argues against any laws in physics, in thermodynamics, chemistry. None of those are argued about. I mean, they may do research on it, but it doesn't actually matter what somebody believes about gravity, right? You can believe anything you want about gravity, I suppose, but gravity doesn't change based on what you believe. And so the idea that human nature could possibly be like this also, it never really comes into play. So we are all made in a certain way to live well in particular ways and not so well in other ways. And the truth is, for most things that Christians believe, you actually don't even need the Bible. You could use medical journals and psychological journals, and you would come up with a lot of the same things, even though they would have exorcised God from the project. So these are some of the terms that students hear come out of a secular humanist framework, anything from romanticism to behaviorism. There's a pretty wide range to postmodernism. So you see, there's not really a big overlap between secular humanism and materialism, because materialists do believe there is a truth. Even if it's a small truth about material things, they believe that's a capital T truth. So the social sciences do not believe that anymore. We're just out here socially constructing our identities, and we're socially constructing what we believe is true. So at one point in critical theory, in Marxist thought, human beings were shaped by their work, by their economic conditions. And then Habermas and others brought in another idea that after Hitler came to power, they were pretty shaken about that. And they said, well, maybe human beings are not so not as constructed by their economic condition, but they are by the media. So they knew how Hitler had used the media. And we are highly influenced, maybe even much more than then. And we have issues of sort of multicultural identity, gender identity. That is a huge part of the social sciences right now. Psychology, secular psychology, focuses almost exclusively on the self, and secular psychology is all about helping you feel good about your sin. Do you remember, I mean, some of you are probably almost as old as me. Do you remember the book, I'm Okay, You're Okay? That's where it started. I mean, that's where in popular culture it started. That's what secular psychology is primarily about. I've become increasingly worried about multiculturalism. I had an experience that kind of revealed to me why I was uneasy about it. I taught a class this summer, had a lovely young Latina woman in class. Usually our PhD students are not as young as she. And one of the things I always ask the PhD students in the first class is, I say, you're getting a PhD. I want to know why. What's your dream about this? Why do you need a PhD? What are you going to do? And Maria, I mean, that wasn't her name, but Maria said just immediately when it was her turn, she said, I'm going to be a college president. Okay, wow, that's good, that's bold. Okay, it wasn't 2 days later in class, and this was a summer class, so we were meeting a lot. And she said, we were coming back from a break, I don't know what had been going on in class or whatever, and I sit down and we get ready to start class, and Maria says openly to me and to the class, I was told that the only reason I got in this PhD program is because I'm Latina. So everything in me starts rising up. I'm thinking, wow. And I said to her, you know, Maria, to get into this PhD program, three people read your file. They're all professors. And they ask themselves two questions. One, can this person do the work of a PhD student? And is there evidence? And number two, is there a reason for them to do the work? Like, do they have sort of a dream? Do they have a reason for being here other than just being in school? And we have a much generally older population in our program because of that. And then I said to her, you're not just a Latina. The truth is, from my standpoint, this wasn't my Christian class, but I took this chance. I said, God made you to be a college president. And that's your primary identity. And your secondary identity, which will help you and also be a struggle, is that you're Latina. And that would be the truth for me. Whatever our identities, our multiple identities are, they'll both help us and not help us, right? You see, we've lessened people's identity. So they go around now, the young people go around thinking, I'm Latina, or I'm Black, or I'm white, or I'm this gender, or I'm that gender, or I'm confused gender. We've lessened people's identity through a process that was actually supposed to bring more freedom for people, and it's actually ended up in ways working against them. Well, Maria was so relieved. She should not be my student because I'm really not in her field. But at the next break, we're walking to what my church calls St. Arbucks for a class break on campus. And Maria comes running up to me and she says, please be my advisor. And I said, well, I'm really not in your field. You really should get somebody else. And I named some people for her. She said, no, I want you to be my advisor. It's not because of me. You know what it was? God touched her. The truth touched her, that she has a big purpose in her life. That's what God says. Jesus is the most multicultural person who ever lived. I mean, even in his genealogy, he's got five women, four of which are not great examples. And they're not Jews. The first person to bring a whole city to Christ is a Samaritan woman who's a really big sinner like me. I love that story. In John 4, in John 8, the Pharisees are angry with him again for healing on the Sabbath. And one of those Pharisees says to him, aren't we right? You are a Samaritan and you have a demon. You have demons. And Jesus said, I don't have demons. Every indication Jesus gives, I have other sheep in my flock, right? Every indication he gives is just like 1 Corinthians 12, where Paul describes the body of Christ. Like an eye can't say to the hand, I don't need you. And the foot can't say to the body, I don't belong to you. Martin Luther King summed up that whole chapter by saying this: for some odd reason, I can never be who God made me to be fully until you are who God made you to be fully. And you'll never be who God made you to be fully until I am who God made me to be fully. He said, that seems odd, but that's the way God's universe is made. And then it goes on to say that those you think are the least are actually the most important. Imagine if we really thought that, like walking around campus, that the people that we think are least, that we just walk by all the time, are actually the most important to the campus. So there is knowledge in Christendom that does not exist anywhere else. And multiculturalism to Jesus is a totally different picture. So their major issue, the major issue for secular humanist is individual freedom. That's really the sort of place where it is. And it's also true in Christianity, individual, you know, we're all made in his image and we all have a purpose. Individual freedom is important, but it's in a context of community and of the world, not just the world that believes in him. So one of the things that Stephen Smith, who's a political scientist, Christian political scientist, I think he's at USD, University of San Diego, he's a Catholic, says that freedom is a term that inspires respect, even reverence. In the abstract, everybody admires it. However, the expansion of one person's freedom often means a contraction of another person's freedom. If you recognize and protect the freedom of the pornographer to market pornographic materials, you reduce the freedom of people to live and raise their children in pornographic-free communities. So, also a secularist, certainly not a Christian, John Rawls, a philosopher who passed away not too long ago, said tolerance has to be a two-way street. This is not happening, actually, in the States nor in Canada. Tolerance is not a two-way street. Because we've actually just kicked off the Christian organizations off every California State University campus in California. So there are lots of stories about these things, but if you're going to do tolerance, which is a sort of low-level thing, it's going to have to be across the board, which is very difficult to do. The biggest problem in secular humanism is the word sin. Sin really just means missing the mark of human flourishing. I'm doing things that are actually not good for me. In the book of Jeremiah, several times, through Jeremiah, the Lord says, follow my rules or follow my laws so that it will go well for you. His laws are not there to make us unhappy. They're there to make us well. Christianity, I found, is the only safe place for self-knowledge. And the reason is it's the only place where you can do something with it, right? If you really got serious about knowing yourself and you weren't a Christian, it would be too depressing. I mean, in pantheism, you're going to have to live another life. You built up all that karma. I'd be in real trouble. I'd be coming back a whole lot. So the conundrums of secular humanism are this. They're trying to find moral truth in human dialogue. So this is Habermas and Etzioni. They're all good philosophers, but they believe that somehow, it reminds me of the King Arthur tales. I used to love to read the King Arthur stories, where King Arthur brings all these people together and they're supposed to create this new global community. Now we do that with things like the United Nations. Sometimes totalitarian regimes determine this. Sometimes democracies, which is sort of like using the bell curve. But the democracies even now are often, the votes of the people are often changed by either executive orders, legislation, or the court system. And then there are media campaigns. The media campaign has probably been the most successful. So The media campaign changes a language. So universities do this too. You take something that used to be associated with something bad and you turn it around to good. If you remember in Jesus' dialogues about the end times, one of the things he repeats over and over is that in the end times, people will call what is evil good and what is good evil. So here's Anne Hendershot, who wrote a book on defining deviance down. She says that we used to use words like crazy and deeply disturbed for suicide, and today we talk about it being having dignity and autonomy. And you remember the, I don't know if you got the same People magazine about the young woman who had committed suicide because she had this brain cancer. But this is how the culture changes things. It changes things by changing the language or changing the sort of modifiers of the language, the things that are going on around it. Pantheism is the last one I'm going to present. And pantheism is also a spirit, believes in the spiritual reality, but it's westernized. So for, I would say, Europe and North America, pantheism really turns into something like spiritual but not religious. And that's what I used to be. I used to tell people I was spiritual and not religious. Now here's the translation. If you ever hear this at St. Arbuck's, you'll know what it really means. It means I'm better than you because I don't need a God or Jesus or anybody to tell me how to live. I can be good on my own, okay? That's what it means. And I can tell you someday, or you can hear it, how good I was on my own. Okay, so even the Dalai Lama, when asked whether or not you could be both a Christian and a Buddhist, said, once a certain degree of realization has been reached, a choice between the two paths will become necessary. He said in Pasadena, California one day, Christ will not take you to the same place as Buddha. And that is absolutely true. So what are the differences? The major difference between pantheistic religions and monotheistic, and particularly Christianity, is how they deal with desire and suffering. So Buddha was a prince. He gets outside his kingdom. He travels around, he sees all this suffering in his father's kingdom, and he spends the rest of his life determining, how do we get rid of suffering? And he decides that the problem with suffering is desire. And if you just didn't desire things, you wouldn't suffer. Because you wouldn't have them, but you didn't desire them anyway, so nothing would be wrong if it was gone. So desire blocks enlightenment, it leads to suffering. And to avoid suffering, you have to get rid of desire. In Christianity, you redeem desire. God says over and over, I want to give you the desire of your heart. Like the desire of your heart is your whole life purpose, right? Now, it's not naive in Christianity. God doesn't believe that we only have great desires and he wants to give us every single desire we have. But there is a structure to redeem the desires that are wrong. There's a way of redeeming that's wrong. So I often give the example of pornography. So when I was out with all these different people and in this different world, we watched pornography. So when I came to Christ, I knew immediately it was wrong. And I used the scripture but I knew the scripture said, if I confess my sins, he will forgive me and cleanse me of my sin. So he immediately not only forgave me, but he delivered me from ever wanting to look at it again. Okay, but there are consequences to things like that, sins that you have done for years and years. And the consequence for me was this. I never wanted to look at it, but I could be driving down the road, down the freeway in Los Angeles. You have a lot of time in Los Angeles driving on the freeway. And the scenes from old pornographic things would come into my mind. And I would engage them, and then suddenly I'd realize what I was doing. And I would stop, not the car, but I would stop and I would say, God, you saw that, and I saw it, and I confess that it's a sin, and I ask you not only to forgive me, but to cleanse me from that, to cleanse me from these pictures. Now, I was immediately delivered from wanting to watch it, but it took probably about 3 years until I realized I never saw that again. But God does cleanse. He doesn't just forgive. He also, every time we confess that and ask it, he actually cleanses us. There is a kind of redemption in Christianity that's nowhere else. And sometimes even Christian kids say, you know, they wonder, how can that happen? You know, why can Jesus do that and I can't just do it myself? Well, Jesus came as the Word of God, who came in a human form and experienced, this was probably one of his major purposes, to experience every temptation known to man. It tells us several times in Hebrews, every temptation known to man. So there's not any temptation that you and I would ever face that Jesus has not done perfectly. So when he dies, he can't, of course, stay dead. So he resurrects, and now he has spiritual power. The West has almost forgotten. I mean, we want to make Jesus out like he's just a logical human being, but Jesus regularly walked through the cities and cast out demons. This new generation that's going into college now is full of pantheism. They've grown up with Oprah Winfrey. They've grown up with Harry Potter. They've grown up with all of these pantheistic ideas. And except for the few that have become materialists, a lot of these students, I'm not talking about the students at a Bible college, but a lot of the students I meet really are going to have some demonic problems. They are having demonic problems. In the United States, they now estimate, and these demonic problems manifest themselves in things that we might call psychological or even material. So they drink and they have these sort of hookups. So they have apps. So somebody apps out everybody else and says, you know, they want sex. So somebody else comes. They agree not to know each other's names. They agree to never contact each other again and not to hold each other responsible for anything that happens. And the estimate is that now 40% of the students coming out of universities in the United States will have contracted a sexually transmitted disease that still doesn't have a cure. This is a spiritual thing that's happening. It's not just a natural thing that's happening in the culture. It is a spiritual thing, one that only Jesus can take care of. The pantheists do believe in spiritual things. I don't know if you can see this, but it's monks developing a sand mandala. They started doing this in the United States right after 9/11. And they wanted to develop a mandala to call forth the Buddhist Prince of Peace. Now, the peace in Buddhism is very different than the peace in Christianity. And you can see why, because I just shared with you the thing about suffering and desire. The Buddhist idea of peace is this just sort of no-mindness, right? I don't care. I don't want anything. That's the opposite of Christianity. I do care. I care that children in Africa are starving. I care that there aren't mechanical engineers. There aren't media people who are Christian. I care about those things. Now, so they spend 2 weeks doing this. While they're doing it, they're chanting prayers to bring forth the spirit. And then they're scooping up the sand, and they're putting it in. I guarantee you it's been done here. They're putting it into running water, whatever the running water body in the city is or the area. And they're calling forth these spirits. And you know what? I believe them. Because this is the spirit that's over our North America. Kids are going to this spirit because they're afraid, and they promise them peace. But it's a peace that doesn't care about anything. It's a peace that you get by not caring, by not feeling. This is why a culture has got to have one religious moral framework. You cannot run a nation on multiple religious frameworks, because at some level they all share certain things, and those are, like, C.S. Lewis did a good job in The Abolition of Man talking about what were the commonalities among the religions. But ultimately, at the end of the day, they are not alike. you know, regardless of what Oprah Winfrey wants you to believe, they do not all lead to the same place. Even the Dalai Lama will tell you that. So what are spiritual laws? This is by a man who has just retired from Fuller a couple of years ago, Fuller Seminary. He was a missionary in Africa, and he wrote about spiritual laws. He says, first of all, there are dispensers of spiritual power. There's a close second, there's a close relationship between spiritual and human realms. Third, there's a major difference between God and less powerful spirits. Fourth, authority and power flow from allegiances. So you promise yourself to one of these authorities. And that cultural forms can be spiritually empowered, like the mandalas, and territories and organizations can be subject to spiritual powers. So we're back to this picture. Leslie Newbegin says, the Christian claim is that though the Christian worldview can in no way be reached by any logical step from any of these other worldviews, nevertheless, the Christian worldview does offer a wider rationality that embraces and doesn't contradict the rationality of these others. So every single one of these worldviews begins with a faith statement. That everything is material is a faith statement. You cannot prove that by using the science's own method. All of them hold some principles of Christianity. All of them hold some principles outside of Christianity. And Christian principles go beyond the secular, and they actually unify the true principles of these secular philosophies and theories, and it has a higher rationality. So what's actually happened to the secular university in particular, and secular schools, is that we are turning out people who are poorly educated. 95% or more of the world believes in some spiritual framework. It's not the free open marketplace of ideas, and they deny their very own first purpose, that is pluralism. And they reduce speech, because you have to reduce speech to do intercultural or interfaith or even interdisciplinary things. And what happens is, in the reduction of that speech, you lose moral knowledge. You lose the knowledge that Dallas Willard talked about that's in Christianity and nowhere else. So thank you. Let's take questions or comments or anything you want to do. I don't care. Thank you.
I got it working. I know some of you might need to get going, and if you do, I just want to encourage you that we do have Mary Poplin's books available in the back if you would like to pick those up. But we're going to take a moment for some Q&A. And so we'll pass around the mic so that we can get it into the recording and everyone can hear, and we'll ask some questions, and then we will break. So are there any questions for Dr. Poplin?
Hi, Dr. Poplin. Thank you for sharing all of that. I'm an elementary school teacher in Abbotsford, and one of the things that is starting to happen in British Columbia is a very new awareness of our First Nations people and First Nations principles, and our new curriculum requires that we now be incorporating those into our education system. Mm-hmm. And I find any time you go anywhere now to anything, they begin by thanking the people who were here before us and thanking them for the use of their mountaintop or their prairie. And I'm just wondering what your response would be to Christian educators who are now facing this new spiritually charged curriculum.
Right, that's happening in the health centers and the universities too. We're all teaching kids Buddhist meditation to help them with their psychological problems. I think it's unfortunate, but one of the things we have to know about the Native people is a whole lot of them are Christian. I don't think Christians know that, but there's been, there's quite a number of Native tribes that are pretty much mostly Christian. I would try to find those people and get advice from them and get them to even come in. I know there's a couple of books I would recommend to you that were written by people who became Christian, who are Native American in from the United States, and there's probably more books here. But there's one book that I particularly recommend by a man named Richard Twiss, and it's called One Church, Many Tribes. One Church, Many Tribes. And he actually got a degree from Asbury Theological Seminary. They gave him one. I mean, they really said, if you want to come here, we will just pay for the whole thing. And he went, and he wrote quite a bit. He actually developed music that was kind of First Nations music, but it was actually for Christian worship. And there's another man who kind of writes in the same vein, and he also talks about the problem of the church. I do believe that the church hasn't done enough, hasn't worked enough. That there are little churches. I know the church that I'm with now is trying to adopt a church on a native tribe, actually in Arizona, because they're so poor. And a lot of Christian churches are actually quite wealthy. And so I think we do need to partner with them much more so that we can understand and they can help us understand. But the other book's called White Man's Gospel, and it's the one that sort of critiques the Christian church, or basically gives them. He was from the American Missionary Alliance, and his name doesn't sound very native, but his name is Craig Scott Smith, or else Scott Craig Smith. I forget which direction it goes, but it's White Man's Gospel, and I would do that. It is problematic. They certainly would not let you bring in Christianity in that way, so it's a tough thing, but I think I would look for partners that are First Nations people. And because they're oppressed inside their own First Nation community often for actually becoming Christian. But there are quite a number of them. They're just difficult to find.
And in fact, it was a Native American man that actually led you to Jesus.
Yes, absolutely. He was from a family that was very spiritual, and half of his family went to the dark side and half of the family went to the light side. And so is the way it's described. So, you know, we're all one. To Jesus, I mean, we have to remember, I'm not talking about people who are outside, but we've got to find the people who are part of his body, the other people who are part of his body that are not like us. Because what I realized is that people from other cultures who belong to Christ actually do get revelation in the Bible that I don't get because of their experiences. Like, I had a student who's a Catholic priest from Ghana, and he had revelations that, you know, were amazing to me. We once went to St. Arbucks, and he just wanted water, so I bought him the St. Arbucks water. I'm sure it's special. And he read on it that said that 5 cents were of our purchase was going to dig wells in Africa. And he laughed. And I said, what are you laughing at? He says, it says 5 cents. And he read it to me. I said, well, why are you laughing? He said, because the French fathers have been digging wells in northern Ghana since the 1500s. You know, honestly, it's really nice that Oprah and Starbucks want to dig wells, but people have been doing this for a long, long time. Still, one half of the health care in Africa comes from Christian organizations. I mean, it's not like this is something new. And I think that we've got to become more of an international community. And that would be, I'd find a partner. Yeah. Bless you in doing that.
So thank you very much for an interesting and wide-ranging talk. I was interested, I hadn't seen that survey that you mentioned about from Barna that said that 50% of church-going youth in 18 to 28 want to study science. Mm-hmm. I found that really striking, partly because I think Barna also has done other studies that showed that among young people who leave the church, one of their main reasons for citing leaving the church is because they feel that the church does not handle science well.
Right.
So I wonder if you can just sort of talk about the sort of disconnect there and what churches can do to help that.
Okay. I think both of those can easily be true, that when they get to college, I think once a student gets to college, the things they're going to hear is in an atheist science class, right? I mean, not every science class, but the things that they're going to hear are going to work against everything they've heard in the church. My major recommendation is that the church teach all five of these origin stories. Origins, they all have good data behind them. Honestly, they all have data. And make it be known. I think, is Brian here, the president of the university? He was sharing in the faculty seminar that in the National Geographic, there's this article against people who don't like science, right? Those who don't get their children vaccinated for measles and don't believe in evolution, for example. That's one of the things, because it's a fact. Evolution can't be a fact. They weren't there. And we haven't seen a species turn into another species. And a finch that gets a tough beak is not another species. It's still a finch. And so I think what we have to do is we have to, and maybe theistic evolution is the truth, but we have to, in the church, prepare kids better for what they're going to face in the university. We've got to do it. We've got to do it. There's just no way that you can send them out. I see them all the time, even though I don't work with undergraduates. I now attend a church that's full of them because I feel like I should. And my heart goes out to them. But I see, they text me in the middle of the night questions that their roommate asked them. it's pretty crazy, but we could do a lot better job in the church. And I don't mean the pastor has to know every scientific theory, but the pastor has you in the congregation, right? We have people in the congregation who could and would like to read worldviews and really introduce kids to this. It's very important. We can't just be playing in adolescent church work. Can't just be running off to the camps with no intellectual fodder for them to fight back. And there's tons of videos that you can use. There's just, John Lennox is, I don't know how many videos the Veritas Forum has of John Lennox, but just listening to John Lennox talk as a lesson where people could just sit and listen to this. This is not something that's rocket science, and you could get any of these books on worldviews and go through them with the students, I think, if you had somebody in the church who was willing to do it, like yourself.
Is there any other questions?
Hi, my name is Jeff, and I'm a teacher here too in Abbotsford. But I teach at a private school, so some of the things that the public school teachers are dealing with, I don't deal with right now. Although I have taught in public schools, and I'm an American myself. I went to secular and Christian universities back in California.
Oh, okay.
And New Mexico, and there's one thing I've noticed over time. And that's how, like J.P. Moreland talks about it, how the church is basically hunkered down and in the church and given over often the universities to secularists, right?
Right.
And my question is, because you had that point on the board where you were talking about that having these types of people in charge of the universities is limiting the speech of those that are Christian, right? Mm-hmm. My question is something I've noticed is when I think about the articles that I read but that are peer-reviewed, regarding anthropology, regarding paleontology, anything like that where you're discussing history or had any sort of possible connection to an evolutionary agenda. What is happening that people that is squelching Christians from doing this type of research that is open to having a Christian answer? I mean, what are the universities doing that say, are they saying we will not back you? Like, what is happening? Because I never see that. I never see research where it's like, okay, we are open to this idea that evolutionary thinking is false about something. I never see that. It's always, what can we do to bolster this?
Right. I believe it's really intentional to get rid of God. Honestly, I think that is the whole purpose, because they know, if they're real scientists, they know they couldn't possibly have the data on that. But, I mean, they have a theory, and that's fine. There are theistic evolution people who have that theory, too. But there are people who lose their jobs in the university and don't get tenure for teaching that, for teaching anything outside of evolution. You're fairly safe if you teach theistic evolution, or you teach evolution and then say casually, you know, there are some of us who believe that this is God's way of doing it. But if you step outside that realm, then you're really in trouble. There are people who have lost their jobs. I think that movie, which was criticized a lot, Expelled, had a lot more truth than it had falsehood in it. If you just look at this thing that Barash talks about, it's my first biology class or something, my first class, it'll just kind of make your blood run cold. It's like, how can he get away with that? How can he get away with it? People don't even see it. You know, honestly, my younger colleagues in my college, and even myself, they don't know, I didn't either. They don't know they're secular. They don't know there's an alternative. They don't know that there's knowledge in Christianity that's not anywhere else. So you see, even the studies that support Christian doctrine, like forgiveness studies that I'm going to use Saturday, there's a forgiveness study that goes through all this stuff and finds the only significant finding they have is that people who believe they've been forgiven by God are 2.5 times more likely to forgive others unconditionally and have higher levels of life satisfaction, okay? When they come to the conclusion of their study, they say the psychosocial dynamics inside the church caused this. That's not what the people said. The people said, I've been forgiven by God unconditionally, therefore I feel I should forgive these people, and therefore, they evidently have higher mental health. But I bet the people who are the authors of that study don't even realize what they did. Because it's just so ingrained in the culture now that Christianity is all about feelings. It's all about your faith. Nobody else has faith. Like materialists don't have any faith. And it's just irrelevant to the world. And here we are sitting, literally sitting on the answers to all the world's issues. And we're silent, or we're silenced. Sometimes I think we're just too silent. And I can be a little louder because I have tenure, and I'm old. I think they probably just look at me and say, oh, she's bound to retire soon. But we have to start speaking, and we have to go back. And, you know, I was sharing in the faculty group that there's Bill Bright, who started Campus Crusade, and Lauren Cunningham, who started YWAM, got together one day for lunch, and they both were excited because they had this revelation the Lord had given them, and they wanted to share it with the other person, and then they discovered it was the same revelation. And what God had said is there are 7 mountains of culture. There's government and law, and politics, there's education, there's family, there's church, there's arts and entertainment, there's science and technology, and there's media. I think it's media. I may have lost one here somewhere. But he said, there are these 7 mountains of culture, and I have my people on every mountain. But they don't know each other. They're disconnected from one another, and they've never torn down and taken the high places. That's exactly what the Old Testament says, actually. If you just remember all those kings, like when there was a good king at the end of the story in the books of Kings 1 and 2, it says, well, Hezekiah was a great king, but he never tore down the high places, right? So it's like, whoop. We have to strategically help people move up the ladder. You know, I remember as a graduate student that my colleagues, they were thinking things about taking over the culture. And a lot of them have. We don't have a strategy because we sort of think we should stay inside the church and we shouldn't cause any problems. Well, Jesus called us a heck of a lot of problems. I mean, everywhere he went, he was a problem. I mean, he was a solution, of course, but for the people who didn't like his solution, he was a problem. I mean, the Pharisees were not too happy about him. So I think we do have this idea that we have to be nice, 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 and I'm not against being nice, but sometimes being nice, and I really learned this really largely from people who've mentored me. Sometimes being nice is being tough. You know, honestly, I've probably never, and it could just be me because I'm so stubborn, but I've hardly ever grown in Christ if I was not suffering. If I hadn't been confronted. The culture hasn't really been confronted that much. We're pretty easily sort of sheepishly sort of go away. But we also don't own the seats of power. So somebody can become the head of Mozilla and Odzilla, whatever it's called, and then 2 days later, gone.
I think that we'll just take one more question and then we'll close it for the evening.
Just on that note, I'm just wondering if there's been pushback when you said that the Christian groups have been pushed off campuses in California. Has the church pushed back on that?
Well, they worked for a year with the head of the California State University, but he just wouldn't give in. So the group that's been pushed off is InterVarsity, and one of the strategies, they felt they couldn't win a lawsuit in California because it would go to the 9th District Court, and that court's pretty hostile. Not pretty hostile, it's extremely hostile. And so what they've done right now is churches that are around the universities have said, please come. You can have your meetings here, but see, they can't announce their meeting on campus. They can't use the campus website, anything. So kids are so creative. I always call them kids because they look like children, but they're not kids. They're young adults, and there's a lot of hope in them, by the way. The ones who are Christian are really amazing. So these students decided, well, if they couldn't advertise on campus through the electronic, they could advertise on their backpacks. So they put things like follow me to this sort of meeting or something, right? And then they have this like flag sticking out of their backpack, so you kind of notice their backpack. So they've been very creative, and a lot of organizations, especially churches that are right around there, say, come and use our place. And actually, they all report they've had an increase in membership. You know, Jesus is that way. Suffering always actually helps the church sort of step up. So, and I would say this before we close. I do work a lot with students. And there are groups of students now all over North America. And I think you even have some of them. There's like this little group called Love, whatever your campus is. So ours is called Love Claremont. There's Love Berkeley. There's Love UCLA. And these are students who are just sold out to Jesus. They also want to become mechanical engineers or go into government and law, but they want to bless the campus. And so ours have decided that the biggest problem on campus is this drinking and sex thing that happens on the weekends. So they are placing a barbecue grill in the middle of the worst dorms, the dorms that are where the most wildness goes on. And they're cooking hamburgers and having Cokes and all sorts of food. And then when the kids come out of these drinking parties, they sober them up. And they're also playing Christian music, like sort of worship music. I'm looking at somebody from the worship band here. So that's how they're sort of loving on the campus. But they're very serious. I'm telling you, a lot of these kids believe they'll be martyred. and that's fine for them. You know, I was in Wyoming a few years ago, and there was a young man there who was into water engineering. And so I'm on his prayer list, so I get a report every once in a while. So here's a guy who's like 20 years old, right? He could do anything. He could work anywhere. And he goes with this organization that digs water wells in places that have emergencies and things. And I got an email from him last fall, and he said that he had been asked by a ministry that was in another part of Africa if he would join them in going into Liberia. This was the worst time. This was like when they had canceled flights. You couldn't fly in, you couldn't fly out, you couldn't go there. And they were going to drive into Liberia and build little hospitals across this particular area that had a lot of Ebola and teach people how to take care of their patients. So, you know, you're 22 years old, right? And now you're going into Liberia. And he then emailed me when they were on day 20 of their isolation coming out of Liberia. But there's a group of young people who are sold out for Christ, and they're growing up in a culture where it's difficult to be a Christian, and it's only making them more radical for Christ. And I think we should pray for them day and night. We should pray for these people because they're amazing. They really are. And they're encouraging. And Jesus can do anything he wants to do with anybody. And I am living proof he can do anything with anybody. So thank you.
Let's give her a hand.